anybody that knows me, I'm old school, so if you didn't get a sheet, my slides are on a white piece of paper, so there's some right up on the front there on that one row if you need a sheet, just notes. Tonight, our title of our message is a topical, where is our focus? And as you'll see, I like to visit a number of scriptures. I think it drives Pastor Ray nuts, and I don't do that on purpose to do that. I think I just drive him nuts anyway. But in Proverbs 17, in verse 24 on the HCSB Bible, which is the Holman Christian Standard Bible, it says, "Wisdom is the focus of the perceptive, but a fool's eyes roam to the ends of the earth." Now, so what Solomon was saying there, he says that wisdom is the main pursuit of sensible men, but fools chase goals that can't be had. So what I'd like to start with is the definition of focus, that which we as born-again believers in Jesus should be most interested in. And that definition means, well, it could be like a focus on a camera, and that's not what we're talking about. The definition we're looking at tonight is the central point of our attention. Now, we have many things today vying for our attention, especially in the technology age that we live in. Information today is right at our fingertips or even at our lips, you know. Just say, "Hey, Siri," or "Okay, Google," or "Just ask Cortana," you know, Cortana, and we're off getting directions, shopping online, recipes, you know, up-to-the-minute news, and any kind of sporting events around the world, you know, et cetera, et cetera. You know, it's available 24 hours, 7 days a week, you know, and I think everybody knows that. We have now become technology junkies and cyber addicts, which leaving many with unhealthy addictions to electronic device overloads. The poet William Wordsworth said, "The world is too much with us." Well, guess what? He said that more than 200 years ago. And he didn't have to deal with 24/7 cable or smartphone devices, alerts, and hyper connectivity at every turn. Now, I'm not advocating dumping our devices. You know, that is impossible. That ship has sailed, and we can't roll back time. You know, we are inextricably linked to them forever. I found this out personally in the last 2 weeks. I watched my smartphone get run over in the middle of the road when I was getting ready to pick it up. I was like, wow, that was interesting. I lost everything I had. A week later, my computer crashed because Avast had with an update that Windows 10 had didn't mesh. Lost everything I had in my computer. You know, and the funny thing was, it was weeks earlier I'd mentioned to my wife, I says, "Hey, man, I miss the days of just a flip phone." Yeah, be careful what you wish for. You might get to experience it. It was not fun. But, yeah, I especially get dependent on some of that technology. Now, this technology, you know, it can be time savers and make things more manageable, or become distractions and suck time out of our lives like almost nothing else can. Not to mention, you know, they can be a deadly distraction while driving. So where is Jesus or God the Father in this picture? Well, we say, well, I've got my Bible here on my smartphone, my iPad, my Palm Pilot, whatever the newest thing is. You know, I got it right here. And there's nothing wrong with that. But how much of that time spent on our devices do we really spend with our Savior and Creator? Before we answer that, let's look at the first three verses of Psalm 139 again. "O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You understand my thoughts afar off. You comprehend my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways." See, God knows. He knows us. The question remains, how much of our time and attention or focus do we spend with Jesus? Is he the central part of our focus in our lives? Now, I don't think for one moment that I'm giving this message because I have this area of my life dialed in. Believe me, I'm guessing I'm giving this message because I have this area of my, I don't think I'm giving this message because I have this area of my life dialed in. I believe that God has brought this to my attention because I'm lacking in this area, and like so many other areas. I believe he has brought this to my attention so as not to get derailed by worldly distractions and disqualified from ministry opportunities. Now, maybe none of you struggle with worldly distractions, you know, and if not, this could be an opportunity for you to pray for us that do. So, something that comes to mind is Paul's words in 1 Corinthians 9:24, and this is out of the HCSB, and this is not on your note sheet. In this version, he says, "Do you not know that in a race all the runners run their very best to win? But only one receives the prize. Run your race in such a way that you may seize the prize and make it yours." Now, every athlete who goes into training and competes in the games is disciplined and exercises self-control in all things. They do it to win a crown that withers, but we do it to receive an imperishable crown, a crown that cannot wither. Therefore, I do not run without a definite goal. I do not flail around like one beating the air, just shadow boxing. But like a boxer, I strictly discipline my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached the gospel to others, I myself will not somehow be disqualified as unfit for service. With that being said, I have to ask myself, or we might need to ask ourselves, how well is my training going? Especially the discipline part. Ouch. Remember, I got this message long before you get to hear it. You know, is there something I can pattern my life after? Better than that, we can look to the Lord Jesus himself and follow him. Jesus, the only one who was and is perfect and sinless in every way. What examples can we find of Jesus? Well, as a child, we see in Luke 2:40, it says, "And the child grew and became strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him." How did Jesus become strong in the spirit and filled with wisdom? And how can that happen for me? How can that happen for any of us? You know, Proverbs 1:7 tells us, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge." The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. You know, do I have a healthy fear, a reverence, and respect for the Lord? Enough that I'm always obedient? No. Clearly, none of us do. But Jesus did. John 8:29 and 30 says, "Then Jesus said to them, 'When you lift up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing of myself. But as my Father taught me, I speak these things. And he who sent me is with me. The Father has not left me alone, for I always do those things that please him.'" See, we see that Jesus was taught by the Father, and that Jesus did nothing out of selfish ambition. Where do I stand in that respect? Do I put others first? You know, do I put the needs of others before my own? Proverbs 2:6 tells us, "For the Lord gives wisdom. From his mouth comes knowledge and understanding." So who or what am I being taught by? Who or what am I spending the most time with? The Word of God or the television? Or my other devices? Remember, I fully believe this message is for me. And you all are just along for the ride. Maybe. You know, that's between you and the Lord. So when we pray and ask for wisdom, Do we know God is faithful to teach us in his loving kindness? Psalm 66:20 says, "Blessed be God, who has not turned away my prayer, nor his mercy from me." You know, and as we continue to look at Jesus as our example, we find written in Mark 1:35, it says, "Now in the morning, having risen a long while before daylight, he went out and departed to a solitary place, and there he prayed." So here we see that Jesus made it a priority to rise up early, early enough that the sun wasn't up, to rise up early to spend time alone with his Father. Now, if we're thinking, maybe he went to bed early, you know, the night before. All we have to do is look back three verses and look at those three verses. And starting in verse 32 to 34, before 35, it says, "At evening, when the sun had set, they brought to him all who were sick and those who were demon-possessed. And the whole city was gathered together at the door. Then he healed many who were sick with various diseases and cast out demons. And he did not allow the demons to speak because they knew him." That didn't look like an early night to me. The whole town was there. So I think that that thought just needs to be put to rest. Now, and yet, I can often make excuses, or sometimes we can make excuses to ourselves about not being able to get up early because, you know, we stayed up too late because we were, you know, fill in the blanks. I've had my own excuses through the years. You know, but hey, sometimes it can happen. You know, and I need to remember that God is not mad or angry with me when I fall short of a commitment that I've made to him, but lovingly works with me for my success through his work. But there are those times when I really can be like a bratty child. And I need Proverbs 3:12, where it says, "For whom the Lord loves, he corrects, just as the father the son in whom he delights." The woodshed experiences. And if I couple that with the comfort of Psalm 86:15, where it says, "But you, O Lord, are a God full of compassion and gracious, long-suffering, and abundant in mercy and truth." And that does bring me comfort when I'm chastened. You know, the Lord tells us in Psalm 32:8, he says, "I will instruct you and teach you in the way that you should go. I will guide you with my eye." You know, God will not give up on his children. Amen to that. Now, we can see that Jesus made it a regular habit or priority to get alone with God and pray. Do I? Matthew 14:23, it says, "And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. Now, when evening came, he was alone there." What an example, our Savior, our Lord. Luke 6:12 says, "Now it came to pass in those days that he went out to the mountain to pray and continued all night in prayer to God." Do I continue all night in prayer? I'll tell you right now, I have never spent a whole night in prayer. Don't know why. That's a long time, and I wonder sometimes, am I just that weak, or, you know, but God is full of compassion and mercy and gracious, and he never gives up on me. He never gives up on us. Now, we need to remember that prayer is not some repetitive, memorized bunch of words from our lips, but prayer from a child of God is adoration towards God, repentance before God, worshiping God, prayers for others, prayers for ourselves, prayers for healing, wisdom, whatever the need may be. And all this prayer is from a heart of love open to God, a new heart which God has given us. In the book of Ezekiel, the prophet had a series of visions. And in chapters 11 and 36, God speaking of the future, the new covenant of the promised Messiah. He says in Ezekiel 11:19, God says, "Then I will give them one heart, and I will put a new spirit within them, and take the stony heart out of their flesh, and give them a heart of flesh." And he says it again in Psalm, or in Ezekiel 36:26, in a little different way. He says, "I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh." God, by his mercy and grace, at the moment we place our faith and trust in his Son Jesus, fills us with his Holy Spirit, and then removes our heart of stone and replaces it with a new heart, a heart of flesh. When I or we have the creator of the universe, who loves us so much that he would give his only begotten Son to die on a crude, rugged cross to pay for the sins of the whole world, to make a way possible for all mankind to spend eternity with him, how is it that we can only carve out maybe an hour, a week, and a midweek every so often to spend time with him? That's the way it was for me for about the first 10 years. You know, and how is it God, knowing all things, knowing exactly how I would respond after accepting Jesus as Savior and Lord, he still freely gives his Holy Spirit to dwell inside me, inside of us, to be our helper. And he gives us a new tender heart on top of that. I figured it out. I figured out why he does that. He's crazy. He's crazy in love with all of us. You know? And you know what else I figured out? I'm crazy in the head for not spending much more time with him than I do. I'm learning it's not that hard. I've set a time to meet with him every morning when I get up. And guess what? He has never been late, and he's never missed one of them, ever. Now, needless to say, once in a while, time will get shortened, but not because of him, but because something on my end. But then again, there's no guilt associated with it. Sometimes things happen. And in 1 John 3:20, John tells us, he says, "For if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart and knows all things." But still, I've made it a priority to have coffee every morning with him in his word. Alone time with God. I see that example from my Savior and Lord. Not the coffee part, but the alone time with God, spending it with him, praying. You know, praying, praising, worshiping him. You know, and the best part is, I can be honest with him, as it should be, because he knows all things already. But better still, I've learned that I can praise and worship and talk with him all throughout the day. And even when things become hectic. Especially when things become hectic. But sometimes it's just a time of refreshing for my spirit. And in turn, it can energize my physical body too, you know, throughout the day. And then there are still times I will kvetch, even though he has everything under his control. That kvetch is just a nice way of saying I can complain, and I still do complain. You know, he has everything under his control, and it's comforting to know he will never leave me nor forsake me. And for sure, I don't need a Wi-Fi connection or a good cell tower signal. You know, there's never a busy signal or voicemail that answers. You know, he is always right there with us. And never with an electronic device in his hand. You know, only half listening. His focus is always on his children. In Psalm 34:15, it says, "The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry." And Psalm 139:7-12 says, "Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall fall on me, even the night shall be light about me. Indeed, the darkness shall not hide from you, but the night shines as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to you. There's nowhere I can run. There's nowhere we can run. God will never give up on us. You know, and the part about his eyes are on, the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous. We are only righteous by placing our faith in Jesus. Philippians 3:9 says, Paul says, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ. The righteousness which is from God by faith. We say that we have no sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Here we go. Let me finish that off right. So, the righteousness of which, go back to Paul, he says, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ. The righteousness which is from God by faith. Now, I will admit, it's easy to lose our focus. And I hope I'm not making it sound like I'm some spiritual giant, because I'm not. Just ask my wife. You know, I struggle and fall and get back up just like everyone else. Because 1 John 1:8 tells me, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. You know, we're all sinners saved by grace. You know, it's easy for me to blame the world for losing my focus, but that's not being honest. Our biggest enemy is our own fleshly desires. In Galatians 5:16 and 17, it says, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these things, and these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. Now, as we looked earlier, by trusting in Jesus, we now have the Holy Spirit in us. And spiritually speaking, we have a new heart, sensitive to the leading of the Holy Spirit. But our biggest problem is we still have our old sin nature that we inherited from Adam. And we won't be free from that until the Lord takes us home. So how do we walk in the Spirit? How do we put off the old man, the old me, and put on the new to live the life, the new life in Christ? How do we do that? You know, the Apostle Paul, he addresses this in the book of Ephesians chapter 4. And we went through that Sunday with Pastor Ray. He took us through Ephesians 4. And in verse 17 through 32... I want to read it from the Amplified Version. You'll find that on one whole side of your sheet there. It's a long read, but it's very self-explanatory. So in chapter 4 of verse 17, starting in verse 17, it says, so this I say, and solemnly affirm together with the Lord, as in his presence, that you must no longer live as the unbelieving Gentiles live, in the futility of their minds, and in the foolishness and emptiness of their souls. For their moral understanding is darkened, and their reasoning is clouded. They are alienated and self-banished from the life of God, with no share in it. This is because of the willful ignorance and spiritual blindness that is deep-seated within them. Because of the hardness and insensitivity of their heart. And they, the ungodly in their spiritual apathy, having become callous, speaking of that stony heart, having become callous and unfeeling, have given themselves over as prey to unbridled sensuality, eagerly craving the practice of every kind of impurity that their desires may demand. But you did not learn Christ in this way. If in fact you have really heard him and have been taught by him, just as truth is in Jesus, revealed in his life, and personified in him, that regarding your previous way of life, you put off your old self, completely discard your former nature, which is being corrupted through deceitful desires, and be continually renewed in the spirit of your mind, having a fresh, untarnished mental and spiritual attitude. And put on the new self, the regenerated and renewed nature, created in God's image, Godlike, in the righteousness and holiness of the truth, living in a way that expresses to God your gratitude for your salvation, being thankful. Therefore, rejecting all falsehood, whether lying, defrauding, telling half-truths, spreading rumors, any such as these, speak truth, each one with his neighbor, for we are all parts of one another, and we are all parts of the body of Christ. Be angry at sin, at immorality, at injustice, at ungodly behavior. Yet do not sin. When you get angry, do not sin. Do not let your anger cause you shame, nor allow it to last until the sun goes down. And do not give the devil an opportunity to lead you into sin by holding a grudge or nurturing anger or harboring resentment or cultivating bitterness. The thief who has become a believer must no longer steal, but instead he must work hard, making an honest living, producing that which is good with his own hands, so that he will have something to share with those in need. Do not let unwholesome, foul, profane, worthless, vulgar words ever come out of your mouth, but only such speech as is good for building up others, according to the need and the occasion, so that it will be a blessing to those who hear you speak. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, but seek to please him, by whom you were sealed and marked, branded as God's own, for the day of redemption, the final deliverance from the consequences of sin. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor, perpetual animosity, resentment, strife, fault-finding, and slander be put away from you, along with every kind of malice, all spitefulness, verbal abuse, malevolence. Be kind and helpful to one another, tender-hearted, compassionate, understanding, forgiving one another readily and freely, just as God in Christ also forgave you. This right here is a great template for my walk in living the new life in Christ that God has given to me, has given to us. You know, and as I look back in my, God has brought me a long way, but I look back at a lot of that and it's like, boy, did I visit that many times in the beginning, in the early years. And I know it can creep up and pop up at any time. But, you know, we need to take ownership of this new life we've been given. Whenever we get something new, what's one of the first responses? You know, to protect it and take care of it, right? New car, new bike, new whatever. Man, we're all over it. You know, how about our new life in Christ? You know, do we cherish our new life in Christ that leads us to eternal life with God, with Jesus, the Holy Spirit? You know, it leads us to a new resurrected body made for heaven. Do we cherish it like that? And do we cherish it like something new that we get on this earth that's just going to corrode and fall apart and not last? In Revelation 21, verses 4 and 5, John, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he tells us, "And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away." Then he who sat on the throne said, "Behold, I make all things new." And he said to me, "Write, for these words are true and faithful." Wow. for the former things have passed away. How about my old life, the way I was? They're passing away. They haven't all passed away, but they are passing away. And he makes all things new. He's made us new. He's given us his Holy Spirit. He's given us our new heart. You know, back in verses 22 and 23 of Ephesians 4, where it says that regarding your previous way of life, you put off your old self, completely discard your former nature, which is being corrupted through deceitful desires, and be continually renewed in the spirit of your mind, having a fresh, untarnished mental, spiritual attitude. Now, how are our minds being renewed? In Romans 12, 1 and 2, and that's on your sheet, in the J.B. Phillips translation, it says it like this: with eyes wide open to the mercies of God, I beg you, my brothers, as an act of intelligent worship, to give him your bodies as a living sacrifice, consecrated to him and acceptable by him. Don't let the world around you squeeze you into its own mold, but let God remold your minds from within, so that you may prove in practice that the plan of God for you is good, meets all his demands, and moves toward the goal of maturity. That can only happen by spending time with him, by spending time in his word. Do I cherish his word more than anything that is earthly or worldly? You know, it truly boggles my mind how God has given us everything possible to succeed in following our Lord Jesus. And yet, I can so easily lose my focus on him, only be distracted by my own fleshly desires. You know, it is a great comfort to know that the Apostle Paul struggled with the same things. You know, in Romans 7, 21 through 25, in the New Living Translation, Paul says it this way. He says, I have discovered this principle of life, that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. I love God's law with all my heart, but there is another power within me that is at war with my mind. This power makes me a slave to the sin that is still within me. Oh, what a miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? Thank God, the answer is in Jesus Christ our Lord. So you see how it is. In my mind, I really want to obey God's law, but because of my sinful nature, I am a slave to sin. Wow, I mean, this is who wrote most of the New Testament. And an awesome man of God. And he struggles. He struggled just like I struggle. Just like we struggle. We all struggle. Thank God, the answer is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Wow. One thing we can take comfort in is that we have the entirety of God's word at our fingertips anytime we want. Cell phones, iPads, the like. But Paul didn't. None of the New Testament writers did. But they each were filled and taught by the Holy Spirit as we are. Jesus tells us that in John 14 and John 16. You know, each one of them was inspired by the Holy Spirit to put down in writing what God would have us to know. Now, it is up to us to take hold of it, read it, digest it, let the Holy Spirit speak and instruct us through it. Now, let's not lose our focus on the most important thing in life, finishing well. So we too will be like the faithful servant in Matthew 25 and hear the Lord Jesus say to each one of us, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. You know, as we choose to keep our focus more closely on Jesus, that which the Holy Spirit gave us through Paul will be a great help. And that's in Ephesians 6, 10 through 13. He says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand." I'm going to stop right there. On your sheets, you have the whole armor of God listed before you on your handout. So let's all make that choice to take a stand against the wiles of the devil and put on the whole armor of God. You know, let's make it a priority to meet with the Lord daily if you haven't done so already. I know for me, having morning coffee with Jesus is the best way to start my day.